Welcome to this presentation, where we will focus on one of the most recent approaches on the genetic of the suicidal behaviors. As you probably know, suicidal behavior is a big problem worldwide. Over 1 million of people suicide every year in the world, and suicidal attempts are even more frequent. It is one of the leading causes of death in many countries in the world, and particularly is a troublesome issue in psychiatric disorders, and of course also for the choice of the treatment. Therefore, the possibility to predict and to understand from a genetic point of view, that could lead also a therapeutic point of view, this behavioral problem is extremely important for us. So, starting from the evidence, as I mentioned, the suicidal behavior is up to 10 times more frequent across psychiatric patients compared to the general population. And this may also suggest that there is some kind of overlap in the genetic background between suicidal behavior and the genetic liability for psychiatric disorders. Moreover, we have another issue that has been extensively discussed during the last decades, that we can have also a phenomenon called treatment emergent suicidal ideation. That during the treatment of antidepressants, it has been suggested by some that patients, at least some of the patients, may develop suicidal ideation. And this, of course, is a very dangerous clinical phenomenon. From a genetic point of view, we know that the heritability, that means the part of the explained variance due to genetic, is quite high for suicidal behavior, ranging from 30% to more than 50%. It means that probably half of the determinants of suicidal behavior comes from genetic factors. This is why it's important to investigate them and to know them and to use them also in clinical practice. The problem is that the genetics of psychiatric disorder, as you probably can imagine, is quite complicated because some genes can increase the risk for psychiatric disorders, for suicidal behavior, in the so-called pleiotropic way. That means that a single gene can have more than one effect, and the combination of genes is even more complicated. This is why in this presentation we focused on the so-called polygenic risk scores. Polygenic risk scores that are an advancement compared to what we were used to do in the last 20-30 years. For many years, we focused on candidate genes. For example, this review of 8 years ago, we summarized the knowledge at that time about the candidate genes in the serotonin genes. You know that serotonin is one of the neurotransmitters probably most implicated in suicidal behaviors. And at that time, we thought that a combination of genes in the serotonin system could be relevant for suicidal behavior because there is indeed some evidence in this direction. And our suggestion at that time was that with a background of liability genes in the serotonin system, together with early life events and temperamental issues like aggressivity, impulsivity, and life stressors like can happen during the adult life and psychopathology can lead to suicidal behavior. The system is still valid. The idea is still valid. The only point that is an advancement compared to a few years ago is that probably we are not talking about a few genes in the serotonin transporter of tryptophan hydroxylase. We are talking about polygenic risk scores. As I mentioned, is a combination of variants across whole genome, thousands, hundreds of thousands of genes. But talking about genetics of suicidal behavior, we should always remind that as clinicians, we know that suicidal behaviors are also due to other aspects, temperamental aspects, and particularly impulsivity, that is quite common also in completed suicide. In my experience, in my clinical experience, These personality features, personality traits, are quite important in the suicidal behaviors that we see. Other than this, also the point of aggression and anger. Anger and aggression traits are quite common, as also suggested by some psychoanalytic theories in suicidal behavior. And therefore, this, as we will see later in this presentation, is important from a clinical point of view, but also from a genetic point of view could be interesting. In the recent years, genetics started to work very, very hardly about the possibility to discover the genetic basis of suicidal behaviors. In this recent paper, a very large study was performed, collaborative study, including thousands of suicidal patients. And the first result that I am telling you today that is very, very interesting is that the so-called polygenic risk score, that is, as I said, a combination of signals coming from the whole genome, polygenic risk score for major depression, that means the liability of the genome to develop major depression, is indeed a risk factor for suicidal behaviors. But what's more important in that it is another study where the sample was divided into subjects affected by depression, subjects affected by bipolar disorder, and subjects affected by schizophrenia. And in all three groups, there were suicidal and non-suicidal patients. Again, the polygenic risk score, independent from diagnosis, so polygenic risk score for depression, independent from the clinical diagnosis. So also schizophrenic patients can have a polygenic risk score for depression. Well, what's interesting is that this polygenic risk score was indeed associated with suicidal behavior in all three groups. And as you can see, the variance explained, R squared is in the range of 0.2, 0.4. That means one third of the variance was explained by this PRS. And this is quite interesting and promising, even if still not ready to be used in clinical practice. This is why those evidence prompted us to investigate the possible effect of polygenic risk scores on suicidal behavior in the samples that we are collecting. And we did not only investigate the polygenic risk scores of depression as shown in the previous paper, or the polygenic risk scores of major psychosis. We included 22 different psychiatric, but also metabolic, like inflammatory or cardiometabolic traits, to see if they have some kind of influence on suicidal behavior. And not only in suicidal attempts, but also in the phenomenon that was not considered in the previous studies, that could be very interesting, of the antidepressant treatment emergent suicidal ideation. Then we did another step that was composed by the idea of investigating those genetic pathways that are influenced by the compounds that we know have an anti-suicidal effect, like lithium, clozapine, or ketamine, to see if these specific genetic subsets are more valid in terms of prediction. You can see the paper that is submitted for publication at present, but is already available on MedArchive, as you can see in this part of the slide. As for the methods, we use the standard strategy of investigating the polygenic risk scores obtained through the largest data sets available at present, and with the standard quality control and step procedure that you can see in the paper if you are interested. And we used as a target population four large samples of patients affected by schizophrenia, depression, and bipolar disorder. And eventually, we performed a meta-analysis across the whole cohorts. And this just to let you know which are the sources of our PRS values that are the largest genome-wide studies performed so far on the different psychiatric and medical disorders. target phenotypes, the definition is of course a little bit heterogeneous across samples in KETI and the GSRD, that is the group for the study of resistant depression, European group, STAR-D and STEP-BD. Mainly the Hamilton depressing rating scale was used, but the Calgary also in KETI, and as you can see, different scales, but they are pointing to the same question of the presence of the suicidal attempt. The treatment emergent suicidal ideation was available only in STAR-D and in the European treatment resistant depression sample. And then in terms of sample size, you can see that the size is not huge, but is sufficient to this kind of investigation. The suicidal attempt was present in all four databases with a total of about 700 cases compared to 3,800 out of 3,800 total population, and the treatment emergent suicidal ideation was available in over 200 cases. As I mentioned before, we added another possible investigation, that is the question if the investigated traits or diseases are somehow more associated with specific pathways that are involved in the mechanism of action of drugs that are known to have an anti-suicidal effect. And therefore, we followed these steps that I will not go into detail to identify which are the subset of genes that are involved in the mechanism of action of those drugs. Pathways of mechanism of action that you can see displayed in this slide that are the ones that are most commonly suggested to be involved in the action of ketamine, lithium and clozapine. And let's go to results. The first result is that the PRS, polygenic risk score for measured depression, was indeed the most, the strongest finding of our study. And this is quite interesting because it is exactly replicating the previous evidence of the two papers that I showed you before, that indeed genetic liability of measured depression independent of the diagnosis of the patient, schizophrenia, bipolar, or depression itself, is indeed associated with suicidal attempt. And this is a quite independent sample compared to the papers that you have seen before. The second, even if not so strongly significant, is the association of the coronary artery disease with suicidal attempt. And this is also referring to a wide literature that you're probably aware of, the association between cardiological issues and depressive and suicidal behavior. The third, also interesting, is association with the PRS, the genetic liability for loneliness. That is not, as you can imagine, loneliness itself recorded in terms of clinical investigation, but is loneliness from a genetic liability. And the genetic liability for loneliness is indeed also associated with suicidal attempt. And the last, of course, is the PRS of suicidal attempt itself that has been developed in the previous paper. It was also associated with suicidal attempts. Unfortunately, for treatment emergent suicidal ideation, the sample was not so large, and therefore also the associations are not so strong. But we can see that more or less are the same with the PRS of major depression and the PRS of coronary artery disease. Here, there is a little bit of shift compared to other PRS, for example, the PRS of schizophrenia, that probably you have seen in my other presentations, that has been associated with poor response to antidepressants, is indeed possibly associated also with suicidal attempt, even if as a trend, suicidal attempt treatment emergent, that is in line with resistance to responding to the antidepressant. And the other one is the one about insomnia. As you can see, Insomnia, again, is a trend, it's not significant, but insomnia is something that we know that also from a clinical point of view is sometimes dangerous for the risk of suicidal attempts in patients. But again, we are talking about PRS, not the clinical insomnia, but genetic liability toward insomnia. It's quite interesting to see that the direction of the association of our main result of polygenic risk score of major depression with suicidal attempt is constant and consistent across the four different samples. As you can see from the meta-analysis, the effect size is very, very similar across all the samples. And what's even more interesting, as you can see in the right side of the slide, is that the increasing of the quantiles of the polygenic score, so it means the more load, genetic load you have for major depression, the higher is the risk for a suicidal attempt. And this is also been observed also in other similar analyses. However, the variance explained, as you can see in the left part of the slide, is not so high. We are talking about fractions of percentages. The last analysis we performed was the focus on a subset of gene sets that are involved in the mechanism of action of the compounds that have unknown anti-suicidal effect. And these are the results. Of course, don't worry if there are too many, because I can summarize them for you. Mainly, the idea is that you can see in the left the specific genetic pathways that are involved in the mechanism of action of the anti-suicidal drugs. And unfortunately, results are not so strong, because if you focus on the right, we underline in pink the possible findings. The one that is somehow interesting is the alpha adrenergic receptor activity, because it's the only one that is significantly explaining a relevant part of irritability of the suicidal behavior. And this is quite an interesting finding, because if you remember at the beginning of the presentation, I mentioned that the clinical factors of anger are somehow linked with suicidal behavior. And it's also known that the noradrenergic system is linked with anger and impulsivity behaviors. And therefore, this is a possible suggestion that the modulation of the pathway linked to the adrenergic system could be one possible hint for the predisposition for suicidal behavior. So going to the end of this presentation, we have seen that indeed suicidal behavior recognizes a relevant part of genetic background. Studies are starting after the decades of analysis on candidate genes to find which is the liability behind this suicidal behavior. And the liability is lying into the polygenic risk scores, the combination of gene variants across the whole genome, not just single candidate genes. And in specific, the genetic liability for major depression is indeed consistently associated with suicidal attempts. And this has been evidenced by previous literature and our analysis as well. And what's most interesting is that this risk factor of major depression genetic liability is present also in patients that have a different clinical diagnosis, bipolar or schizophrenia. The same genetic liability is probably influencing also the treatment emergent suicidal ideation and behavior. Interestingly, we saw that cardiometabolic genetic background is also somehow modulating suicidal behavior, and this is confirming other previous evidence from converging studies. The focus on the genetic pathways that are linked to anti-suicidal drugs indeed did not yield very strong findings, probably except for alpha adrenergic pathways. Obviously, our study comes with limitations. The polygenic risk score for the traits that we used had not sufficient power if we compare to other studies in literature, because we are working with samples that have relevant size, but not huge, of course. Then the other very important limitation is that the samples that we used have not been specifically collected for the evaluation of suicidal attempts. However, and this is the last slide, our study opens the perspective of many other possible future directions. For example, the analysis with machine learning methods combining different PRS and clinical factors together, probably we can explain a larger part of the variance. Also the use and investigation of EQTL, that means the expression information coming from genome, which are the real effective and modulating genes across the genome. Then we can do also specific analysis on locally expressed genes. Not all the genes are expressed in the brain, and therefore the analysis of the genes that have more possibility to influence suicidal behavior being expressed in the brain is another possible step. However, in conclusion, we have shown that and confirmed that the genetic liability for major depression is indeed a genetic factor for suicidal behavior across all diagnoses. And we are starting also to understand which are the possible genetic modulators of treatment emergent suicidal ideation. Thank you for your attention.